commanded a widow there to feed you." So he set out and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the town, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and said, "Bring me a little water in a vessel so that I may drink." As she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, "Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." But she said, "As your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am now gathering a couple of sticks so that I may go home and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said. But first, make me a little cake of it and bring it to me. And afterwards, make something for yourself and your son. For thus says the God of Israel, the jar of meal will not be emptied, and the jug of oil will not fail, until the day that the Lord sends rain on the earth." She went and did as Elijah said, so that she, as well as he and her household, ate for many days. The jar of meal was not emptied, and neither did the jug of oil fail, according to the word of God that was spoken by Elijah. Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Many of you know that in the first year of Abby's life, it wasn't quite easy. In the first 12 months of her life, the clearest medical diagnosis that we had was this ambiguous term, failure to thrive, which came to mean, at least in my mind, we have no idea what's going on. I was working full-time at Habitat for Humanity at the time, and I returned to work after 6 weeks of maternity leave with a child who wasn't gaining weight for some unknown reason. And over that next 12 months, which included a hospital stay, 6 weeks on a feeding tube, sometimes multiple weekly doctor visits, driving back and forth to Silva because we couldn't find a person to stay with a child on a feeding tube. My dad was watching her. David and I both were so exhausted, and we were desperate for answers about what was happening. But we never got them. It was all that we could do to put one foot in front of the other. We didn't know what the outcome could be or would be. But in that stretch of time, it was a long time waiting with this tiny little one in our arms who we loved so much and so desperately wanted to be okay. But we had no idea when or if that was going to happen. As you know, the story turns out, well, she's fine. You could never know that she was ready to thrive when she was in that first year. And under these circumstances, I think that if someone like Elijah had appeared and approached me and asked me to give them something that I needed for Abby, I would have had some choice words for them and sent him on his way. And this prophet Elijah, he had been in an ongoing feud with King Ahab and Queen Jezebel. And our story for tonight really lands us right in the middle of all of that conflict. So just before what we read tonight, King Ahab had taken Jezebel as his wife and had built an altar to Baal and began to worship this god. And through Elijah's word to the king and queen, we hear that God is a little less than happy. And the text tells us even that Ahab did more to provoke the anger of God than all of the kings before him. So Elijah had this really fun task of delivering this message to the king and queen, that there would be a drought in the land, no rain, not even any dew would fall to the earth, until God said otherwise. And as soon as Elijah delivered that message, God told him to get out of there. So he sent him to this little creek east of the Jordan where he could drink and where God would send ravens to bring him food. And eventually this drought caught up with Elijah, as we saw in the story acted out for us tonight. So God sent him over to Zarephath, where Elijah was told that this widow would be there to feed him. And interestingly enough, Zarephath is in Sidon, where Queen Jezebel was actually from, and it's a place where Gentiles lived. Elijah would be fleeing to a land inhabited by foreigners. I think it's really interesting how God is always reminding us throughout these stories to look in the places where we least expect to find evidence of God's presence, in those places where we don't imagine that we're going to meet God or where God might be at work. But that's exactly where Elijah found himself, in a foreign land, at the mercy of strangers for his survival. So as Elijah, on behalf of God, was confronting Ahab and Jezebel, I couldn't help but think about what a familiar story this is. We see it all the time. When people people who suffer most from the results of these battles and disagreements are usually never the ones who are engaged directly in those ideological conversations, or the ones who get any say at all in the decisions. And the plot is really no different in this particular story tonight. This widow is from the same land as Queen Jezebel, a land where the majority of the people worshipped a different god. The god to whom they would appeal and from whom they would expect rain to come to replenish the resources of the earth. So she hadn't been privy to these conversations between Elijah and the king and queen in the royal palace. She may have had no idea of Ahab and Jezebel's actions and decisions that landed all of them in this drought and famine in the first place. So the widow was dealing with just the immediate situation where she found herself. She was out gathering these sticks so she could return home and use what little bit of oil, a handful of meal that she had to make a final meal for herself and her son before they died of starvation. Their reserves were empty. This would literally be the last meal that they had together. The truth is, neither Ahab nor Elijah experienced a lack of food or water in this whole chain of events. Neither of them had to face that. Ahab, likely by the nature of his position as the king, would have been protected from the implications of this drought, I'm guessing. He would have been surrounded by abundance of resources. And until this moment, Elijah had not really reached a moment of desperation either. He had not experienced that deep hunger and thirst. When the water supply had dried up that he was depending on near this creek, he was forced to move away from the place where God had been providing for him. And I really have to wonder if Elijah, because of the protection that God had offered him, if he had any idea, at least at the very beginning of this scenario with the widow, what he was asking of this woman. As she prepared to cook this meager meal and then die with her son, Elijah had been out in the wilderness and God had provided him with a source of water, and these ravens were delivering a regular supply of bread and meat to him each morning and each night. He hadn't personally known that desperation, the deep pangs of hunger, the aching heart of a mother who has reached the very last of her resources to feed her child, and the agony of knowing that they both would die soon. If he had known, I really have to wonder how he could have even posed such a question to her, even at God's prompting. How could he even dare to ask this woman to share the last cake of bread that she had, no matter how small it was, that would be taken from this tiny amount that she had for her final meal with her child? Ultimately, in the story, God continued to provide sustenance, not only for Elijah, but also for the widow and her son. She was given the promise that this supply of oil and meal would not be empty until rains returned once again to replenish the earth. And while this particular story ended up working out in the end, for both Elijah and the widow, I want to linger for just a small moment. When this widow was at the end of her rope, when her food supplies had dwindled to so little that she could do this one last tiny meal with her son. First of all, as Stan reminded us when he retold the story with the children, when we hear the word widow in Scripture, we know that we need to pay attention. There's a particular picture painted of a widow, one without means or access to economic security, in the absence of a husband or male relative. And this widow was no different. She had run out of options for feeding herself and her child. And as a widow, she was on her own. She had nothing left to draw from. She had resigned herself to this heart-wrenching task. When Elijah requested that drink of water from her, the widow responded and turned to go get it for him. But as she was leaving, he added that question. While you're at it, bring me a little bit of bread to eat, too. And her immediate response really wasn't, sure thing, it's coming right up. Yeah. Instead, she turned to him and with brutal honesty laid out the situation in which she found herself. As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. And she went on to explain the rest of the story. But this isn't just a story of extravagant hospitality. We can try to tie it up with a meat little bow and make it feel good, but it's not just about that, where sacrificial sharing takes place and everything just really gets tied up neatly in the end. And while this eventually does happen, the widow in the story offers Elijah and us an honest naming of her despair. telling him exactly what it is that he's asking of her in this particular moment where she finds herself and her son ready to face their deaths together. Honestly, I think she was pretty kind about the whole thing. I wouldn't have blamed her if she had had some choice words for Elijah after his request. And I'm guessing, just as mothers all across the ages have done, she stretched her meager resources as far as she could using that oil and meal already as sparingly as possible, deeply aware of the decreasing amounts of the ingredients with each meal she prepared. Coming to each meal with a tiny bit of food in hand for her child, maybe not even eating herself, while she was also thinking in the back of her mind about the bigger picture, the hours and days and weeks ahead where she may not be able to provide food for her child, all the while being as present as she could be in that moment. And I'm guessing that she spent countless hours trying to figure out what to do next. What could she do to change this situation? I'm guessing that she had exhausted nearly every possibility that was in her power before coming to this desperate moment. As I thought about this story, I thought about those moments of despair and desperation, and they can take a lot of different forms. We've all experienced moments like that in our lives in one way or another, whether it's emotional or spiritual or physical. Desperation is desperation, whatever package it comes in. And it can look like it did for this widow, and it looks like that for so many people in our world, wondering where the next meal will come from and preparing for the worst when all the avenues in front of us have been exhausted. But I think it can also look like this. A parent in the midst of an illness with a child, when there are more questions than answers, when you're exhausted and depleted, and you're not sure that you can walk through another day. It can look like when you're walking through an illness of your own. It may be visible and known to others, or you may look and seem completely healthy to an outside observer, so you mostly carry it on the inside by yourself. It can look like a friend or family member dealing with addiction or mental health issues. Again, it may be visible and known to others, or you may be carrying the weight of it alone. I think it could look like a nurse or a physician being caught within systems that seem to inhibit more than enable your work as healers and promoters of good health. Or being at the end of your own reserves as you gird up your strength to deliver difficult or devastating news to a patient or family. I think it can look like a social worker or a therapist accompanying clients and patients through the mazes that our world sets up for people to navigate to meet the most basic needs that they have. Feeling so incredibly torn between the immediate needs of you and the larger systems within which you also try to provoke change. I think it can look like a first responder or physician or nurse caring for one more patient in the throes of addiction and seeing the ripple effects that this has in people's lives, even in your own as you absorb the secondary trauma again and again and again. I think it can look like being a friend to someone who struggles with seeing their work in this world, when what you see when you look at them is such deep and amazing beauty, and you know that no matter how many times you say those words to them, it's not enough. I think it can look like a teacher accompanying your students, not only in their educational endeavors, but also as the one who bears witness to all of the barriers to their learning, whether it's home life or mental health or economic realities. I think it can look like writers and storytellers gifted with words, seeking to name the despair alongside the hope and sharing those gifts without always knowing where those words are landing or taking root. I think it can look like being a parent or grandparent to a child who has lost their way, when what you want more to do more than anything, is to throw your arms around them and hold them tight and remind them that your love for them never ends, while knowing that all you can do is really walk alongside them at times without words and without that embrace that you're longing for. I think it can look like a pastor every week trying to find those ways to hold on to hope, trying to find the words for that deep and abiding hope in the midst of so much turmoil and hatred and violence and grief, when the words are sometimes so incredibly hard to find. But what encourages me in this story of the widow and Elijah was the widow's ability to really clearly name what her reality was. She didn't deny it, she didn't inherit it, Elijah, and respond to his request without question. She named it directly and plainly to him. She named what her situation was as he made his request to bring her something to eat in the middle of this terrible famine and drought. She still had some agency and power in that moment to say in not so many words, "Who do you think you are asking me for food at a time like this? You have no idea the magnitude of what you're asking from me, do you?" Now, I don't know what to make of this almost magical thing that happened in the story, where she received this promise that this tiny container of oil and meal would never be depleted until this drought and famine came to an end. In some ways, it feels like a good case for prosperity gospel theology. And the truth is that our stories don't always get tied up as neatly as this particular one did. But regardless of the outcome, I keep coming back to that widow's ability to name clearly for herself and in the presence of someone else what her priority was in that moment. There's something powerful in naming where we are and what our reality is, especially when we feel so utterly powerless and at a loss for how to take a next step, how to enter the next moment, or how to keep moving forward at all. It gives us at least a tiny bit of agency. And in the case of this story, I think that the widow created a possibility for human connection in both directions. For Elijah to recognize this widow and the awful circumstances in which she found herself and her son. But also for the widow to name out loud to another human being what was happening to her. And for a brief moment, seeing that he too was likely facing the same fate as she and her son were facing. How else would she have been able to make that shift from thinking that Elijah was a total jerk to going back home and responding to his request and bringing him a small morsel of bread, sharing from what little she had left for her son and herself? This ancient story comes to us as we witness others and experience ourselves in all kinds of situations of desperation, where we don't have answers, clear answers or paths to follow, where we sometimes feel like we're at the end of our ropes in terms of resources for even the next small step forward. We feel it as we watch this endless news cycle that's in front of us 24/7 that highlights our own kings and queens who have built altars to the gods of war and violence and wealth and fame. We feel it as we hear news of mass shooting after mass shooting and try to discern how in the world to respond to the deeply ingrained violence that surrounds us in every single direction. We too feel powerless and desperate in the face of what seems so insurmountable. But I think we can take some guidance from this unassuming widow as she was out gathering sticks to prepare this last meal. Another voice called out to her in the form of Elijah, reminding her that she was not alone, that she was not the only one in this situation, thirsting and hungry in the midst of a drought and famine. We can take guidance from her and keep naming our own situations and realities together as parents and grandparents, as siblings, as physicians, nurses, teachers, therapists, social workers, first responders, writers, service workers. Our survival depends on sharing our stories and having the real human encounters that remind us that we're not alone in those moments of desperation. We are in good company. Our healing and wellness comes in community together, not in the isolated corners that we sometimes are tempted to flee to when we feel that we are at the end of our road. 10 years ago, when we were still gathering as a circle over at St. George's, I would often slip into the back of the service after it started and slip out before it ended with Abby swaddled in my arms. I needed to be reminded that I was not alone. And when desperation and despair had a firm grip on me, I needed a clear reminder that they did not have the final word. And friends, I believe that the way that we remind ourselves that desperation and despair are not the final word is together in